excited to have you with us during this time as we gather together to honor God and to fellowship with each other and to be in this special place as we worship. It's a rainy day out there, and I'm glad you're here. They always say in church circles, you can tell about a rainy day who really wants to be in church. And so thank you for being here today. It's good to be with you this morning. One thing I want to know real quick about the rain. There is later this afternoon, after the 11 o'clock service, a big youth kickoff. Barbecue, the whole nine yards. We're supposed to be down at the Scout Lodge. The rain has made that now probably not the best idea. So we got word this morning they're going to be doing that in the gym following the 11 o'clock service. So if you know youth families or something, point them towards the gym for that big kickoff this afternoon, not down to the Scout Lodge. Appreciate that. As we continue in our worship service this morning, let us call ourselves to a time of prayer.
To raise its ugly head, that you, Lord, would remind people greater than the worst evil that is out there. And so, Lord, send us forth into the world to proclaim that goodness, that grace of yours that overcomes all understanding, that overcomes all evil. Lord, as we gather here this morning, we do so with worship. So hear our prayers as we cry out to you, but hear, Lord, also our praises as we sing glory and holiness to your name. It is in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, the Lord, who we pray these things.
Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of the Holy Spirit that has the scriptures to pray and your word to proclaim. We may hear your joy. Please stand as I read the scripture for you. The scripture comes from the book of John, chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave the power to become the children of God, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. This is the word of our Lord.
Try to lift high the story of Jesus Christ and who he is and what he's done. It calls for some elements, some worship elements that sometimes fall by the wayside in other times and places. And we thought that it was appropriate for some of those things for this particular series. And so I hope that you will enjoy some of those elements as we rediscover some of the classic traditions that help us to highlight who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. As we begin this time here in this new series called The Genius of Jesus. As we get into the sermon today, would you pray with me? Now, Almighty God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, would you grant us eyes to see, ears to hear, hearts to receive your word this morning, that it indeed would be transformative, so that when we leave here in a short while, we do so more in the image of Jesus than when we came in. Amen. When my son Rylan was about 18 months old, we had been invited by some friends to go and join them for an Easter party at their house. And we were very excited about this. We were new parents. It wasn't our first Easter with Rylan, but this was probably the first one where we actually had an opportunity for him to enjoy kind of some of the classic things, the egg hunts and stuff like that. So we were excited about the party. All of our friends were going to be there. As we arrived at the house that was hosting the party, all of us kind of got there at the same time. Cars pulling up, doors opening, kids hopping out and running in. We started running in across the lawn to the front door, and as we were approaching it, the door opened very slowly, and what emerged was someone, I still to this day do not know who, dressed in an Easter Bunny costume. And the only thing that I could say about what happened at that point is the children were so excited and running toward the door. As the bunny came out, it was full stop, sheer terror, as they all turned and ran back to their parents, screaming at the top of their lungs. Because this giant bunny had come out of the door, and none of the kids were expecting it, nor did they have any idea how to process the event that was happening in front of them. It was, at the same time, one of the most horrific things I've ever witnessed and one of the most hilarious things I've ever witnessed. Weeping, gnashing of teeth, just sheer terror. And as this poor person in this Easter Bunny outfit, I said, I don't know who it was to this day. I think that they tried to slip, you know, they didn't want anybody to know who was in there, whose idea this was. He came out and tried to come to a few of the children. The parents were trying to get the kids to take pictures. None of the children were having it. So eventually we just had to put the bunny in the driveway and get the kids inside the house so that this horrible traumatic experience could just be over. Well, as we were getting the kids into the house, my son, Rylan, stopped and seemed to all of a sudden now be curious about the bunny. And so he actually would come out and he kind of walked around the bunny. Now, he wouldn't let go of my hand, but he would walk around and he would look. And eventually, we actually have a picture of him sitting in the lap of the bunny, still quite terrified, but wanting also to have this moment with this bunny. Today, we're talking about incarnation, the incarnation of Jesus. And I share that with you because that really is a great picture of incarnation. When the idea puts on flesh and standing in front of you. All the kids knew about the Easter Bunny. This was not a new concept for them. But when this 6 foot whatever Easter Bunny is standing in front of you, it's a whole new reality. And that's what incarnation is. When the idea puts on flesh and is now standing in front of you. The Gospel of John begins with an amazing statement. Now, I want to be clear here. I'm not talking about that it's just a wonderful description of Jesus, or that it's a very poetic language, or if it's a masterfully built sentence or anything like that. What I mean is the Gospel of John begins with an amazing statement, an almost unbelievable statement. Listen to it again, as we heard it a moment ago. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. John is the only of the four Gospels that doesn't begin with the narrative. John doesn't run straight into the narrative of the story of Jesus. The Gospel of Matthew begins with the genealogy, sort of as the introduction to the novel. Yes? He gives you the background. He says, you know, all the begats, so-and-so begat so-and-so, and so-and-so begat so-and-so, to set up the narrative. He does so still in a narrative way. The Gospel of Mark begins with John the Baptist, and then the baptism of Jesus. The Gospel of Mark just skips over all the other stuff. The Gospel of Luke goes way back before, and goes to Zechariah, and the birth of John the Baptist, and then the divine conception of Jesus, etc., etc., starts in the narrative. John is the only one who begins with a theological statement, a doctrinal point, as he launches into his gospel. He doesn't go straight to the narrative. He wants to make sure you understand the background, what's going on here theologically. And this is true to who John is. It's true to what John is trying to accomplish in what he's writing. A lot of people have a lot of problems with the Gospel of John because it doesn't fit with the other Gospels. We call the other three the Synoptic Gospels because there's symmetry between them. The timeline kind of makes sense. John has things out of order as compared to the other ones. Well, John's not trying to tell you the story in chronological order. That's not his point for writing. John is writing to try to make the case for you to believe in Jesus as the Messiah. John is less concerned with getting the order of the story exactly right and more concerned that you understand that this Jesus that stands before us is Almighty God and that we need to believe in Him. The authors and the translators of the New Living Translation of the Bible is one of my favorite translations. They actually describe it like this. John was less concerned about Jesus' actions than with what his actions said about him. That's what John's trying to do. In the beginning was the Word. Where have we heard that before? In the beginning. It goes back to Genesis, doesn't it? It goes back to Genesis. John starts out his gospel very intentionally, and he uses these words that would have immediately transported his audience back to the beginning, back to Genesis, words that they had memorized since they were just little children. He wants them to go back there. He wants them to be thinking about Yahweh, God's work of creation, and all that happened in the beginning by the hand of God. He's laying the groundwork here for something that is truly amazing. He is preparing the reader for the fact that the Jesus which he is going to be talking about is Yahweh God, is the God who was at creation, is this same God of the universe, and now he has come to earth. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh. Why would God, the creator of the universe, put on flesh? Why would he step out of all that is heaven and come to be among his own creation? What kind of event would precipitate that? Well, we know that sin is the problem that has separated humanity from God and that needs a solution. But John puts it far more eloquently. John puts it far more eloquently in verses 10 and 11. He says, he was in the world, and the world came into being through him. Yet, the world did not know him. The world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. That's the problem that precipitated Jesus coming to be on earth with us. The creation, his own creation, no longer knew the Creator. No longer recognized who he was. Can you imagine that? I still have as one of the greatest memories of my son's infant time, coming home from work, and he would be in the little swing that would kick him back and forth, and walking up to the swing and kind of looking around at it until our eyes would meet. And when our eyes would meet, the blank stare that had been on his face all of a sudden turned to a smile. Because when our eyes met, he knew me. I'm his dad. I'm his creator, sort of. And when our eyes met, he recognized me. Go back to the Gospel of John. What he's telling us is that when the Creator showed up, the creation did not know who he was. Things had gotten so twisted, so lost, so broken in the world that when God stepped in, nobody seemed to know it. Now he goes on and says that those who would choose to believe, those who believed in what Jesus was saying, indeed, they were given the opportunity to become children of God. So Jesus comes in, the Word became flesh, it says, and we have seen his glory. And what is that glory? Grace and truth. Grace and truth. Now scholars will point out the idea of the divine interacting with humanity is not unique to Christianity. All the other theistic religions of the time, the ancient Near Eastern world, as well as the polytheistic religions of the time, had stories of the divine interacting with humanity. That is not unique in and of itself. However, what they will then go on to tell you is that there is a difference. Because in these other religions, what you would have is the deity transforming themselves into human form, or perhaps just appearing in human form. And what the scholars will say is that the key to John chapter 1 as it pertains to the Word becoming flesh is that word became. In verse 14, the word became is where all the power lies. The Word did not transform into humanity. God did not appear in human form. The Word became flesh. He was born as a child in the same way that we are born as children. He was raised in life the same way we are raised. He lived the life that we lived. The Word became flesh. That's not appearance. That's not transformation. That is incarnation. Incarnation. Becoming one of us. In my opinion, this is one of the most important and foundational theological truths of our faith. That our God wanted so desperately to be in relationship with his people, with his children, that while we were caught in sin, and while it was dragging us away from him, keeping us from God, he came to us. In order to rescue us, he came to us. You hear people in the church say things like, Jesus will always meet you where you are. That statement is founded on the idea of the incarnation. Without the doctrine of the incarnation, you can't say Jesus will meet you where you are. But we can say it. Because Jesus did it. Jesus met humanity in our sin by coming and facing the same life that we all face. Showing us that he has the power to redeem and rescue us from this if we will follow him. Now, you might be thinking, awesome. This is a really cool doctrine. I get it. I've even heard it before. What does it have to do with us today? As we sit here in the church in 2016 on this rainy Sunday morning, what does the doctrine of incarnation mean for us? Well, friends, I anticipated you would ask me that question, so I have an answer. As we move deeper and deeper into a post-Christian reality, I believe that the statement that John makes, he was in the world, and the world did not know him, is just as true today as it was when John wrote it. That statement, that Jesus Christ was in the world, and the world did not know him, is just as true today as when John penned those words. Jesus told us that in this life, that we will have trouble. And Jesus said that he had set for us an example of ministry. Do you remember just after the Last Supper, he gets down on his hands and knees and he washes the feet of the disciples. And he says, you call me your teacher and you're right to do so. So if I, your teacher, have done this, I've done so as an example. So that you will go and do it also. So we know we're called as fellow brothers and sisters, as followers of Jesus, to go and do as Jesus has done. So we, the church, the living embodiment of Christ in the world, are called to live incarnationally. We're called to live this doctrine of incarnation. Ministry that goes to those that we're trying to reach. Incarnational ministry. Going to those that we are called to reach. The church enjoyed a wonderful time several decades ago, where culturally, people understood who we were. And they accepted who we were. In fact, they even helped us to be who we were. When I was growing up in Abilene, Texas, you couldn't go into the grocery store on Sunday morning before about 11. Why? Because everybody was in church. No places were open. When I was growing up in youth sports, nothing was scheduled on Sunday mornings until afternoon. So that you could go to church. That's what happened. That was the culture of the day. As we have moved on, as we've gone down the road some, we don't share that same cultural place in the world today. The culture has changed. And now, not only is the culture not really accommodating to what we do here in the church, oftentimes they look at us with a great deal of cynicism. Because when the culture started changing and things started happening on Sunday mornings and people weren't coming to church quite as often, we, and I mean the divine we, the universal church, we began to shame them. Rather than going out and inviting them into something that was better, we began to shame them for not being in church. And we began to say, you need to be in church more often. And why aren't you coming to church anymore? Etc., etc., etc. And so part of the reason that I believe that the culture has not looked on us with the same sort of accommodation is the incongruity of the message that we have preached. Because when we're inside here, we talk about a God who was amazing and came down to earth to be with us. And that Jesus will in fact meet us wherever we might find ourselves. And then we would go outside into the world and we would shame others for not coming into church. And the incongruity of that message turned people off to who we are. So what's the answer? What's the answer? Incarnation. Incarnation. Incarnational ministry. Ministry that goes to where the people are. Ministry that meets people in the midst of their pain and their suffering and their questions and their doubt and says nothing more than, I'm with you. I'm with you. Ministry that doesn't condemn or cast judgment or look down on. Ministry that simply comes alongside and says there's something better for you. God has more for you than what you were experiencing in your current reality. This is what the world needs. A church who's willing to go out to them and be with them the same way our Savior came to us. When we found out about this appointment, the very first thing that my wife and I did was we called a friend of ours who was a realtor. And we put our house up on the market. We began looking for houses over in this area. And it was an interesting experience because as I talked to my colleagues, other pastors from around the annual conference, they would congratulate me on getting appointed to Coker. And they were happy for me. And they said, how great, you don't have to move. And I said, well, we are moving though. Why are you moving? You're already in San Antonio, aren't you? And I said, well, yes, but we're over there in Lotus. They said, well, but why would you move? And what I eventually realized in these conversations was I kind of had to just shut it off because we were talking from two different perspectives here. And I don't know if it's the church planter in me or the evangelist in me or what, but I can't do ministry to a community that I'm not a part of. That's just how I've been taught. The incarnational ministry, this foundational piece of what Jesus has done for us, is such a big part of kind of how I understand to do ministry that the thought of not living in the area with all of you never even occurred to me. Because, friends, our community is hurting. And they need to know that we're going to be with them beyond the 1 hour on Sunday mornings that they are with us. We need to be able to see them and pray with them in the cereal aisle at HEB. We need to be able to run into them at the park. I need to see them in the hallway of Hidden Forest Elementary and meet the teacher like I did this last Thursday. That's incarnational ministry. When we meet others outside of this place. Because the days are gone when we can hang a cross and flame out front, fling open the doors, and everyone will pile in. God has called us to go out. To be incarnational in our ministry. Because that's exactly what Jesus has done for us. Gail O'Day is a scholar from Candler School of Theology in Atlanta. This is what she says about John chapter 1. The Word becoming flesh is the decisive event in human history. Indeed, in the history of creation, because the incarnation changes God's relationship to humanity and humanity's relationship to God. The incarnation means that human beings can see, hear, and know God in ways never before possible. The genius of Jesus is that he is a God who did not stay separate from his creation. He is not a God who said, I cannot sully myself by going down to where they are, by stooping to their level. The genius of Jesus is that he is a God who says, I so desperately want to be with my people, I will become one of them. I will become one of them, and I will walk with them, and I will lead them back into relationship with Almighty God, their Creator. That's the genius of Jesus, that he became one of us. And now he calls us, now he sends us out there to join our brothers and sisters and walk with them through their questions, through their doubts, through their fears, through their anxieties, through whatever life might throw at them. We get the privilege, the high, high privilege of walking with them through it as the embodiment of the body of Christ. What an incredible privilege. So brothers and sisters, we will not just talk about the doctrine of the incarnation here. We will live it. Amen? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this time. And we thank you that you are not a God who has stayed distant and separate. You are a God who has condescended to come to us. What an amazing privilege. So help us to understand that. Help us to know that truth in our hearts in such a way that we would now go and be with others so that they will know that they're not alone, that we walk this road with them, and that we are privileged to do so. I pray it in the holy and precious name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
A Methodist table, nor is it a Protestant table, it is the Lord's table. And that means all of you are welcome. We have gluten-free wafers, so that does not become a burden to you. We use grape juice rather than wine, so that does not become a barrier. We've done everything that we can to make sure that you are welcome to come and participate in this ministry. And to let you all know this morning that we are returning to our former tradition of serving you at the rail today. And so as the ushers bring you forward, you will come on either side of the chancel area, kneel at the rail, and we will serve you communion there and dismiss you from the communion rail, as was our tradition some time ago. So just to remind you of that. But now hear this invitation to come to the Lord's table. The Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We'll take a moment of silence now to confess your own sin to the Lord. And then hear this good news. Christ died for us while we were sinners. And that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Praise God. Amen. And now as we prepare to receive our offering this morning, I would ask you once more to bow your heads in prayer. Gracious Lord, all that we have belongs to you, and you ask so very little in return. And so receive this offering this morning as our way, Lord, of bringing you glory and honor, our way of saying thank you. Bless it so that it may not only help the ministries here at Coker, but so that it may increase your kingdom anywhere in the world. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Let the ushers come forward, please.
Oh, Jesus, please, Lord, be.
history to bring us to this point of redemption. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Son, Jesus Christ, by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, the Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks to the Father, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the supper, he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks to the Father, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This cup is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Say it again. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory. And we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, in confidence of the children of God, let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As we prepare to conclude our service today, I want to offer this invitation, brothers and sisters, if you are ready to be a go-to church, because we serve a go-to God, then I would invite you to make that commitment in your heart today. You can do that where you're sitting in your pew. You can come and pray at this rail and say, God, I'm ready. But if you're ready to be a go-to Christian, then I would invite you to make that commitment to Almighty God today, that you will go to where there is need in your community, in your neighborhood, in your family, and you will simply walk with others as Jesus has come to do with us. If you'd like to unite with COVID, we stand ready to be your church home, brothers and sisters. You can profess faith in Jesus Christ. You can reaffirm your faith after an absence, or you can transfer your membership. Whatever it might be, we stand ready to be your church home. We're not a perfect people, but we are a people seeking to walk with each other and grow closer to God through holiness of heart and life. One last invitation. If you're a teacher, an administrator, have something to do in the schools, and tomorrow is your big day, well, then I would invite you to come to the rail and let David or I pray a blessing over you. So know that this rail is open during our closing time this morning. Let's stand, let's sing our hymn of commitment, hymn number 61, Come Thou Almighty King. Life eternal as well. Go in that grace and in that truth this week. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.